This is the day that love hath made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Roberta and Jeff are away this weekend, and in their place we have a whole lineup of people giving announcements.
Good morning. I'm here to explain the anthem for this morning. Yes, think of me as Fran. And I'll try and live up to it. Anyway, we are going to sing an anthem, and it goes like this. Jason is going to play it for you. It's very short. And then the choir is going to sing that melody twice. And then you are going to be invited to sing with us. If you look at your bulletin, you'll see that in bold print, those are the words that you'll be singing. Please stay seated. And you can just keep singing for the next, I think there's like 9 more times we do it. So lots of times by the end, you should be, you know, very comfortable with it. And then at the end, you'll have some instrumentals doing it by themselves. So I'll try and give you an idea when you can start singing, but do whatever you're comfortable with. Thank you.
I have a happy announcement for all KCPC members who remember and know Barbara Beskind. Barbara Beskind was a longtime, very faithful, and very active member of KCPC. I'm sure many people remember her. She was an inaugural member of the Handbell Choir. She now lives in Pasadena, California, and on February 17th, she will celebrate her 100th birthday. She is doing very well, active, just as active as she has always been. And I have 2 birthday cards. They'll be in the narthex. We'd like to send Barbara as many well wishes as we can, because she asks about you, and even if you don't remember her, she remembers you. So, and she makes it known. So she would be very happy to receive our well wishes. I'll have them in the narthex. Thank you.
Good morning. I have 2 announcements. First, there will be a meeting of the mission committee on Tuesday at 5 o'clock. It's an open meeting. If anybody wants to participate, they're welcome to come here at KCPC. Secondly, next Sunday will be exciting, right? It's the Super Bowl, the 49ers versus the Chiefs. But there's going to be 2 Super Bowls. The second one is SOUPER. So right here, we'll have a competition, our annual Super Bowl, where we'll be collecting donations of cans of soup, cereal, pasta sauce. We'll have a large table out in the narthex, and on one side, we'll have people who think the 49ers are gonna win, and on the other side, you put your donations if you think the Chiefs are gonna win. Okay, so we want to see if we can build some big piles of donations of food for the local food pantries and see whether or not we can predict who wins the Super Bowl. Now, there's a thought that maybe we should have a third table for Taylor Swift, but I'm not sure if I'm going to do that. So, okay, so thank you. I appreciate your donations. We collect food for the food pantries every week, and this will be one of our big collections of the year. Thank you.
Does that do it? Yeah. All right. Are there any other announcements?
I have one.
Come right up.
I'll use this one.
All right.
I've been asked by Rick Marsh to just update the congregation on the status of his wife, Nancy. As you may or may not know, Nancy had emergency surgery about 2 weeks ago, had to go back in for a second surgery. She is now out of the hospital down in Ocala, Florida. She is in a rehab center. She's going to be there for a while, adjusting to the trauma of these two surgeries. And Rick just wants you to know that he appreciates your thoughts, your prayers, and they are planning to hopefully return back here at the end of February. And we'll just keep you advised, but she's doing well. She's getting feisty, so I think that's a good sign.
Any other announcements? Yes, Wally.
Quickie, men's breakfast, Tuesday morning, 7:30, here.
Okay. Anyone else?
Thanks, no. Wally.
I love the spirit in this church. I just want to report that my husband, Tom, is doing very well. He is home and is able to walk with his walker and get in and out of bed on his own. And he's even down on the floor doing his exercises like he has done for a long time. But he's very tired. It's an effort for him to do that, but he's coming along. All right. I know Roberta usually reads something to you in the morning, and just by chance, I found this article in the Upper Valley yesterday, written by Mickey Kohlbeck, and guess what? It's about St. Bridget's Day, and I just couldn't resist bringing it along to read it. As you remember, February 1st was St. Bridget's Day, and our speaker last week spoke about it. It is St. Bridget's Day, the time for lambing, seed catalogs, and garden sketches. Groundhogs and bears are stirring. The sun lingers on the western hills, listing just a bit more to the north each afternoon. We are at the halfway point between the longest winter night and the equal nights and days of spring equinox. When I open my eyes in the morning and look out toward Kibling Hill, it rests in a fiery orange alpenglow as the sun takes its sweet time to crest the pines. The willows along the Ampananusuk are just starting to glow yellow. We smell the change when the dogs and I go out skiing in the slush, and the odors of rodents drive the dogs to leap nose first into the snow. I hear it in the voices of raucous crows and blue jays preparing to claim territory. I smile at the bright blobs of yellow on the butts of a few male goldfinch and red on the purples. It won't be long before these flocking birds go off to their nesting lands and pair up. I love St. Bridget's Day, as it became known after Christianity moved across Europe and the pagan goddess Bridget became a saint. I love knowing that we have made it through the darkest nights of winter. Even though February can bring biting cold, March may dump deep, wet snowfalls, and April, always cruel, bounces between Hawaii and Antarctica. We are reminded on St. Bridget's Day to do the following. Find good omens for the weather. Collect seaweeds and old grass for fertilizer. Examine the stocks in the house. Clean the house. Make special food. Make butter. Make straw crosses to put above the door. Put offerings in the window. Make a good fire. Dance and sing. And that is Mickey Kohlbeck for the Valley News.
Mm-hmm.
Let us pray. Praise the Beloved, life of all life. Invite love into your heart, for divine love gives strength to the weak, courage to face all fears. Divine love brings peace to the heart, peace that is beyond any knowledge. Divine love cuts through the ignorance that fosters greed and arrogance, humbling and breaking open the heart. Divine love severs the veil that separates realms of the profane and the sacred. Holiness radiates through all touched by divine love, a refining fire. Wisdom flows from the heart of divine love to all receptive hearts nurtured in silence. Yes, the divine word is written on every heart scroll, a guide to pilgrims on the way. May each of us awaken to the divine love that peace and integrity and assurance may be born again in every person, in every land. O our soul, praise the Beloved. Amen.
Good morning. Can we have children at heart? And I am so pleased. I think that's Asha. Do you remember me? Okay. Camp Wilmot.
Oh, yeah.
That weekend. Yes, that weekend. I know both of you. Welcome.
Asha, may you please come forward?
You can come over. Leonora, anybody who wants, who is a young at heart.
Anybody who's worked at Camp Wilmot, ever.
Who knows where it is.
Be right.
Who knows what a sleeping bag is. It is so good to see you. Great, and I'm so sorry.
I know.
Noah, that's it. These two people saved my life. Do you really? Come on and sit down, guys. That is so sweet. Oh, my goodness. Oh, careful there. So, good morning. So we know that Miss Roberta usually does this, and so we had an idea this morning, Pastor Kurt and I. So last Sunday, and were you here last Sunday, Leonora? I don't think so, no. So we had a lovely little party for Pastor Kurt's new baby. Aww. And I didn't know if you knew this or not, but this is the theme for Pastor Kurt's baby shower we had, the Very Hungry Caterpillar. So we have some Very Hungry Caterpillar things here. Hey, John, you want to hold on to this one? John, you want that one? No? Oh, Leonora, you want that one? Okay. And we have the Very Hungry Caterpillar book. So I think we're going to read it. Want to read it? All right, ready? Oh, would you like to read it, Asha? Yeah. Oh, I'm so good just
Asha's
sitting
a
here.
She's a professional prayer, so she'll pray it.
Okay, professional prayer. You're like, I did not come here for this, but that's okay. In the light of the moon, a little egg lay on a leaf. Oh, see how it quiets right down when you start to read? One Sunday morning, the warm sun came up, and pop out of the egg came a tiny and very hungry caterpillar, just like this great big one here. Maybe not quite that big. That would be a little scary. Yeah, that'd be some caterpillar. He started to look for some food. On Monday, he ate through one, what's that, Leonora?
Apple,
but he was still hungry. On Tuesday, Julia, he ate through
But he was still hungry.
I see. Yeah, me too. On Wednesday, he ate through three
plums, but he was still hungry.
You know I'm coming for you, right? On Thursday, he ate through four strawberries.
But he was still hungry.
And then lastly, on Friday, he ate through
five oranges, but he was still hungry.
Yeah, as you want to do when you only eat fruit. So on Saturday, he ate through, this is my day, one piece of chocolate cake, one ice cream cone, one pickle, one slice of Swiss cheese, one slice of salami, one lollipop, one piece of cherry pie, one sausage, one cupcake, and one slice of watermelon. But guess what? That night, he had a stomach ache. Yes, he did. Tummy ache is better. That next day was Sunday again. The caterpillar ate through one nice green leaf, and after that, he felt much, much better. Yes. But now he wasn't hungry anymore, and he wasn't a little caterpillar anymore. He was a big, big, fat caterpillar. He built a small house called a cocoon. He built it all around himself. He stayed inside for more than 2 weeks, and then he nibbled a hole in the cocoon, pushed his way out, and he was a beautiful butterfly. Yeah. So here's what I'd like us to think about. A couple weeks ago, Miss Roberta told us how to pray. Remember that? She taught us a five-finger prayer where we, I forgot all the fives. somebody you know, somebody who's close to you, somebody who's far away, somebody who you, and the rest. I forgot the rest, sorry.
Somebody's weak?
Yeah, that's this one. This finger was weak. Anybody remember what the little one was? Anybody remember the little finger? Yep.
The people who you love.
The people who you love, very good. So the caterpillar changes, doesn't he? Caterpillar goes into a cocoon after he does a whole bunch of things, and then he changes. In the same way, prayers can help us change. They can change our heart. So when we say prayers for ourselves and for other people, and here's a big one, especially for people who may not be nice to you, it helps change your heart. Your heart, maybe not the other person's heart, but it helps change your heart. So what I think I wanted to do is we're going to go back and we're going to draw some pictures today and play some games and have some snack. And I'd love us to say a prayer right now asking for love and patience to everyone we meet this week. Okay? So anyone like to lead the prayer? Anyone? Julia? Okay, Julia.
Dear God. Help us to be
kind and patient,
with, with everyone we meet. Amen.
This morning we're reading from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verses 29 through 39. But before we do, I'd like to just say a few words, a couple things about this text. First of all, remember that in those days, the day started at sundown, at sunset, and it also ended at sunset. So it's kind of strange to think of people's day starting just when it's getting dark and you're thinking about bed, but that's what it did. And this story takes place on a Sabbath. And Sabbath was meant to be a day of rest. And there were laws that told what people could do and could not do. And one of the things they could do was they could walk, but they could only walk 2,000 cubits. Well, a little math. It amounts to just a little more than half a mile. That was all they were allowed to walk on the Sabbath. So with that, let us begin our gospel reading with a little recap. Last week, we read about Jesus being in a synagogue in Capernaum, teaching, preaching, and he healed a man who had a demon in him. And so we pick up the story from there. As soon as they left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John, you know, the four disciples. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told Jesus about her at once. Jesus came, took her by the hand, and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, Sabbath is over now, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And Jesus cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. But Jesus would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, Jesus got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found Jesus, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." And Jesus answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns so that I may proclaim the message there also. For that is what I came out to do." And Jesus went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. This is the word of the Lord. Amen.
Please pray with me. Holy and loving God, source of all life, source of all blessing, source of our hope, our faith, our future, our searching, may the words from my mouth and the meditations of each and all of our hearts draw us closer to you, to one another, and to your good creation. In the name of the one who saves us, we pray. Amen. That evening at sundown, they brought to Jesus a hungry caterpillar, an apple pie, a slice of ham. No. They brought to Jesus all who were sick. And so let us, when we worship, practice this practice. Let us bring all who are sick to the one who loves us. And let us lead by example, not asking anyone else to do what we ourselves are not willing to do. Let us bring those parts of us that we struggle with, that are ill, that are sick, that are bad. The Greek word that's used in the Gospel of Mark is kakos, which is the same as kaka. So they brought all that was kaka to Jesus. My friend Al Wesolowski was an archaeologist, graduating from the University of Texas at Austin and Cambridge University in England. In the 1960s and 1970s, my friend Al excavated digs in the American Southwest, in Italy, in ancient Corinth in Greece, and Stobi in Yugoslav Macedonia. In 1976, my friend Al began editing Boston University's Journal of Field Archaeology. His motto as an editor, death to adjectives. My friend Al Wesolowski also was a cartoonist. At the age of 58, he attended the Center for Cartoon Studies in White River Junction and graduated with an MFA, Master of Fine Arts. His thesis was titled Trenchant Tales, recounting his experiences as an archaeologist excavating digs in the American Southwest, Italy, ancient Corinth in Greece, and Stobi in Yugoslav Macedonia. For the last 5.5 years, I met with Al at least weekly. And with the pandemic, our Wednesdays with Wesolowski became an international gathering of cartoonists. So there are about 8 of us who do nonfiction comics and such that have been gathering on Zoom. And I talked to him most every day for 5.5 years. And so I got to know him more than I did, or more than most. Since birth, my friend Al Wesolowski lived with a variety of disabilities. He was born deaf. He learned to enunciate from speech therapists. The amount of study that goes into articulating and enunciating, which he taught me to do as he read my lips. At the age of 30, my friend Al was diagnosed with retinitis pigmentosa, which slowly damages the eye, narrowing the field of vision. Most folks have a field of vision of 180 degrees. When I met him, his vision was about 5% and decreasing. It was like looking through a pinhole. Deaf and blind, Al shared with me once a few years ago that he saw this simply as God's way of ensuring that he was cut off from the world, like being shackled to the walls of a dungeon. By that time, we had pretty good friendship and confided in each other regarding a variety of matters. One of his favorite phrases about my wedding with Katie was, "There was an Alpenhorn," which there was. It's a big Swiss horn. He loved the fact that we had an Alpenhorn. So when he made a theological statement such as this, I could get away with saying bluntly, "Al, that's just bad theology. God does not want to shackle you or protect you from society, or your deafness is not punishment, your blindness is not punishment." After years of discussing this, it became the thing that he recognized is he's here, "I know, I'm about to say, but I know that's bad theology." My friend Al Wesolowski, after being in the hospital for 2 months, died peacefully this past Thursday morning, St. Bridget's Day, of all things. And I feel honored and sad and grateful to have been with him in Hartford Hospital, sitting vigil with him during that time and witnessing a very peaceful send-off. One of my pastors once said, "Grief is a tax on loving." Paul Simon said, "Losing love is like a window on the heart. Everybody can see that you're blown apart. Everybody can see the wind blow." I will miss my friend Al, and there is no way that I can see that he won't influence me every day of my life. To quote, he's an archaeologist, remember, who did digs in Greece. One of his favorite, his last words to me were in Greek, which were panta rei, which means everything flows. And on the other spectrum of things, another favorite quote was from WKRP in Cincinnati, which I asked him to tell the turkey story every Thanksgiving. And that episode concludes, "As God as my witness, I thought turkeys could fly." There's more to that story, but another time. Back to the gospel. That evening at sundown, they brought to Jesus all who were sick. Notice that the Gospel of Mark recounts all who were sick. All, everyone, no exception, every single one, each and every one, all who were sick. Who do they bring?
All.
Universal spiritual care, everyone, no matter race, creed, gender, age, ability, disability, class, no matter what who they love, no matter who they did not love, no matter what they had done or what they had not done. They brought
all.
White collar, blue collar, black collar, green collar, no collar. Greatest generation, silent generation, baby boomer generation, generation X, generation Y, generation Z, millennials, atheist, agnostic, spiritual but not religious, church lady, men's breakfast cook, choir member, and for God's sake, the bell choir members. They brought Democrats, Republicans, Independents, Free Staters, Free Lovers, Back to Landers, Great Againers, Communitarians, Neoliberals, Neo-Fascists, Almond Skinned, Peach Skinned, Cocoa Skinned, Albinos. They brought breast cancer, brain cancer, bladder cancer, prostate cancer, skin cancer, throat cancer, lung cancer, stomach cancer, leukemia, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, colon cancer, rectal cancer, mental illness, physical illness, spiritual illness, heart sick, homesick, motion sick, seasick, anxiety, depression, addiction, early onset Alzheimer's. They brought the psalmist claims the Lord heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. The Gospel of Mark recounts that at evening at sundown, they brought to Jesus all who were sick. In a healthy theology, sickness is not a judgment. Sickness is not given by God to make you stronger. Sickness is not everything happens for a reason for those who believe in a micromanaging, clock-making deity. In a healthy theology, sickness is part of being human, finite, vulnerable. In a healthy theology, the ones who follow Jesus bring to Jesus all who are sick. Note that Jesus does not stay in that one town. Surely Jesus could have set up shop, built a tourist industry around healings, hosted a spa, created a product line of healing goods. Surely there were enough people with illnesses and they would come from all around. However, Jesus did not stay waiting for people to arrive to be brought to him. Jesus went out, prayed in a deserted place. Jesus, perhaps, did his own personal mission study, discerning what the Spirit was calling for him to do next. And then Jesus set out to other towns, to other peoples, to folks struggling with illnesses, perhaps, who had no one to bring them to be healed. Jesus went out to where people were. For Jesus meets us where we are at. Divine love meets everyone exactly as they are and where they are. That evening at sundown, they brought to Jesus all who were sick. This Tuesday at Sunapee Cove at 10:30, we will be celebrating communion. One of my favorite times of the month with one of our honorably retired deacons, who's now a resident at Sunapee Cove, with some piano playing that is like nothing you will ever hear anywhere else, and singing by folks who are, when asked for joys and concerns, these folks with Alzheimer's saying, "I don't have any concerns. Happy to be here." The invitation to the present. And it's a reminder that ministry is not about getting new recruits. These are not new recruits that are going to be filling the pews from Sunapee Cove. And they are there to teach us about what it is to be human, to be finite, to be vulnerable, to teach us how to follow Jesus. This Lent, I know Presbyterians don't practice Lent, but nonetheless it pops up on Presbyterian calendars and the culture at large. This Lent, the weeks leading up to Easter, on Thursdays at 6 p.m., you'll get more information on this because we have another 10 days until February 18th when this Bible study will begin. From February 18th to April 5th, every Thursday at 6 p.m., I am pleased to announce that KCPC is hosting an online Bible study focusing on disability justice. Camp Wilmot chaplain, where's Aisha? She's gone. Noah, you know Chaplain Katie Grosh. Thank you. And our periodic guest preacher, Katie Grosh, will be leading these weekly sessions. You may remember her partner, Ben, preaching in the summer, talking about his work with disability justice and wonderful, provocative work. When, were you here when Camp Wilmot had work day and it was on a Friday and we came here?
Yeah.
So I gave a tour of the sanctuary, and one of the questions I said, "What do you think should be there?" And they said, "Oh, it'd be nice to have a bigger window so you can see more of the sky and more of the trees." One of the kids from Boston said, "Yeah, wouldn't it be great if you had neon lights? It would really like focus on the cross." So I then toured around and said, and this is where Good Day Respite meets, Tuesdays and Thursdays. Chaplain Katie Grosh said, I didn't know you had a disability ministry. I said, I didn't know we had a disability ministry either. I knew it was a wonderful ministry. And Ben Bonds, one of the quotes from him is, all ability is temporary, humbling, and so true. February 18th to April 5th, online. Yes, Stephanie.
15. Start from the 15th, not the 18th.
Okay, thank you. 15th. I can't read my own typing. You'll hear more about it. And I'm in part excited about it for a variety of reasons, but you know, we can go to people who can't come here. I'm glad to see Ed here next to Wally, and I'm glad when I know that when he's not here, he can still tune in. I'm glad that folks who are home because of illness, because of whatever reasons, folks who are traveling, and have we talked about this? The email I got a couple weeks ago from the couple in Pennsylvania that I have not, that tune in every week. Hi, Pennsylvania. The abilities that we have to go to people who can't be here in person with us are humbling. So, more information on that. Log on when you can. Bring your supper and do your laundry. Join in the study as we all prepare for Easter and butterflies and such. That evening at sundown, they brought to Jesus all who were sick. Bring your whole self, all your sicknesses, all that which you see as caca, all your concerns, all your vulnerabilities. Bring your whole lives to worship, to this table, to remember who we are, whose we are, and that love, as the psalmist says, heals the brokenhearted. They brought to Jesus all who were sick.
treat us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our faults. As a father has compassion on his children, the Lord has mercy on those who revere.
No matter who you are, no matter where you are on life's journey, no matter heights or depths or internet or continents, we are gathered to share in simple bread and simple cup. I'm inviting the communion servers to come forward. Everybody, just come on. Yes, come on. No matter if you're an elder or if you're a deacon, you're welcome to gather around Christ's table to help to serve. There are no requirements, there are no fees, there are no obligations when we gather around this table, where we practice divine love. And so let us pray. Holy God, we praise and bless you for creation and the gift of life and for your abiding love, which brings us close to you, the source of all blessing. We thank you for revealing your will for us in the giving of the law and in the preaching of the prophets. We thank you especially in the fullness of time you sent Jesus, born of Mary, to live in our midst, to share in our suffering, and to accept the pain of death at the hands of those whom Jesus loved. We rejoice that in a perfect victory over the grave, you raised Christ with power to become sovereign in your realm. We celebrate the coming of the Holy Spirit to gather your church, by which your work may be done in the world, and through which we share the gift of eternal life. With the faithful in every place and time, we praise, O God, your holy name, and we remember that on the night of betrayal and desertion, Jesus took bread, gave you thanks, broke the bread, and gave it to the disciples, saying, "This, my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance in me." In the same way, Jesus also took the cup after supper. This cup, the new covenant in my blood, do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Consecrate, O God, therefore, by your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and cup, and bless us, that as we receive them at your table, we may offer you our faith, our praise, and we may be united with Christ and with one another, and we may continue faithful in all things. In the strength Christ gives us, we offer ourselves to you, eternal God, and give thanks that you have called us to serve you. And we pray together in the way that Jesus taught, using the words that are in each of our native tongues, whatever they may be, saying, "Our Father, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever." Amen.
To share in this meal, for those who are here in person, the servers will pass the bread, take a piece, hold it so that we can share it all together. The little teeny chiclets are gluten-free. After we've shared together, then they will come among you with our grape juice, and please hold it again and then share. It's so good to be together. Forget not my soul all God's good deeds. The Lord is forgiveness and redeems our life from the grave. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, abounding in love. It is God who forgives all your guilt, who heals everyone from their ills, who redeems your life from the grave, who crowns you with love and compassion. The Lord is compassion and love. The Lord is patient and rich in mercy. God does not treat us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our faults. As a father has compassion on his children, the Lord has mercy. For God knows of what we are made and remembers what we are at our best. As the heavens are high above the earth, so is God's way above our way. So is God's love for us. All your works are holy, for you are our God. You bring justice to the oppressed. From everlasting to everlasting, your love is for those who revere you. We thank you, God, for inviting us to your table, where we have known the presence of Christ and have received all Christ's gifts. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, and let us show forth your praise in our lives through Christ our Savior. Mindful of the time and of the sacred worship hour, in the fullness of time, the ushers are here to receive this morning's offering with physical plates. And I draw your attention to that crazy artwork on the back of your bulletin, known as a QR code, where you can participate in online giving, whether you're here in person or are far away, or just would like to have the ease of going paperless in our environmentally sensitive world. We've gathered on this Sunday morning. The sun is getting brighter. We've passed the midway mark between solstice and equinox. People around the world on St. Bridget's Day have prayed for peace. We have shared in music, in scripture, in kids with very hungry caterpillars, in communion. I offer you an ancient blessing that you may be a blessing to those who you meet along the way. May the Holy One bless you and keep you. May the face of the Holy One shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Holy One look upon you with tender, loving kindness and grant you a peace and a courage like you have never known before. I invite us all to say, Amen.